Today on Steve Robb Reviews, we're going to review how I'm going to turn this 100 watt solar panel with this control panel, and we're going to start pumping some water. So I'm going to take you through from the beginning right to the end on what I've done so far, and this is all mocked up, ready to go, and I'm going to show you exactly what I'm doing, how it's being done, and the wiring. So let's get to it right off the start, and let's go with the solar panel first. Okay, let's just take a look at the specs there first, and there's all the specs on this 100 watt solar panel, and I'll bring you up to the wiring hookup that we're going to put in. And as you can see right here, I've got a connector on the bottom, and this would be like a strain connector and a waterproof connector. And you could see I marked one of the terminals red and the other one black. And if we take a look way inside there, can you just see the tops? Well, they are diodes, and they only let the voltage go in one direction, and that's a good idea when you're using a 100 watt panel. And I always put a diode in for anything that is above 1 to 2 amps. So I do have lower wattage panels, and I've got a 7 watt panel. I got lots of these 7 watt panels, and I never put a diode in there because I found they're not really necessary. But let's take a look at the rest of the system here and see how this is all going to go together. Well, let's start off at the bottom here, and as you can see, I've got one line that goes up to a waterproof switch box, and that just turns my water pump off and on. And I've got one line for a solar panel, and this line here, if we just follow it all the way along, and it's 9 feet long, I got the connectors on the ends here, and it's as easy as just putting it through this waterproof connector and attaching it to them two terminals. And that's pretty much it. Now, if you're wondering why these ends are soldered, well, I'll get to that later. Okay, let's go back to here. And we've got this one here that's going to a battery. And I'll just show you the end of it here. And it's going to be a deep cycle battery. And here's the two connectors on the end here, because deep cycle batteries just have a threaded post with a 5/16 diameter post on it with a wing nut, and you can just tighten these down, and all you got is black and red, and that's pretty well it. Okay, so let's take a look at this charge controller. I bought this charge controller here online off of Amazon, $13. I never used one of them before for $13. I do have a spare up at my camp that's more expensive than that, but I'm going to try this one here. And if we take a look at that charge controller, how they could build that for $13, and it has a built-in timer, so you can actually have this turn off during the nighttime hours, which I like. So apparently this has all the settings that you're going to need. It's a 12 and 24 volt, so when you first start this up, you're going to have to go through the menus, and it's actually got two USB charge ports that I would never use anyways. Here's the instructions for it. I put it in a plastic bag. And if we take a look at all these terminal ends down in the end there, you could see each one of them. After I finished cutting the insulation off, I solder it. And I'm going to show you why. But it's very simple. All you do is we have these same connectors in the bottom of the solar panel. They come through, and each one has a fuse. And I like to fuse everything, and they're all going to be fused at 10 amps. So the solar panel will never put out 10 amps, but the pump will probably draw, the pump I'm looking at, a 12 volt pump, will probably draw around 7 amps. So I used all 14 gauge, so I'm good up to about 15 amps, no problem. So you could see where the connector comes in here. And all you got is just your red and your black for each one. So if we take a good look there, it's hard to tell, but you can see it shows the symbol of solar panel here, shows the symbol of battery, and a light. Well, the light symbol just means your load. And for me, the load will be the water pump. It comes around here, goes out here, and goes down to a switch, because I want everything to be switched. So let's take a look at the bottom of this line and see what it looks like. Okay, just bear with me here. All I've got is the end of an extension cord. Yes, this whole project is built from an extension cord, and I like to use the see-through ones. So you can see the black connector is going to be your ground, and the red is going to be your hot. And that is just going to go to a box where the pump is, plug it in, and that's it. And at the other end, well, you know I used an extension cord. So what I did was, I just saved the end of the extension cord. Yep, there she is right there. I'm just going to plug that into the end of the extension cord. And at the end of this, is going to attach to my water pump. So that's pretty much it right there. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you why I solder all these connections, and I do something else to it as well. So let's just take a look at that. Okay, so we got the end of the wire all stripped of the insulation, and of course I'm just going to put my soldering iron on here, and you don't got to put a lot. Just enough so it wicks all the way down into the insulation. And then what I do is I get my crimper or my pliers and just squeeze it like that and flatten it out. So I'll explain to you why I do that. Okay, so if we just take a good look at that, you could see where it's flattened just on the bottom and the top. And the reason why I do that is because these type of connectors in here are like two flat surfaces. Just imagine two flat surfaces like this, and they just crimp down like this, and on the top is your screw to tighten it up. Now, if you don't solder this connector and you just put it in there just twisted like this, it tends to flatten out, and over time it'll flatten out more to the point that it actually will get loose over time. And this is what I've noticed, where this won't get loose, and you put the two flats on it there, so when you're tightening up that set screw that tightens it down, well, it stays there and it doesn't move. You know, it doesn't spread the conductor wires sideways over time and loosen up your connector and not be as good of a connection either. So I like to solder all the connectors as well. And inside here, I did put where I had to put my fuses together, you know, and join two wires. Well, I always use this kind of a connector here. And that's a butt connector, but you put your heat gun to it and it melts. There's like a resin on the inside here, and it just shrinks this down like some heat shrink tubing and just melts it right together and seals it in good. So the last part I want to show you is the battery box. Now where is it? Here it is here. Hold on. Okay, so here's the battery box. Just a regular battery box, right? And I think this is going to be, I'm going to take a Group 24 deep cycle battery. Now, if you take a look here, you can see where you have room just to put the extension cable through there and attach it to the battery. But you know what? I have tried to use in the past, like just a cheap, what do you call it? Like a tote, like a cheap plastic tote that you get. Big failure, huge failure. You know what happens? You get condensation inside here and it just corrodes your terminals like crazy. So I decided, yeah, go with the battery box. Okay, so now you're taking a look at this panel here and you're wondering, okay, you can't leave this open, right? Well, I'll tell you something. That container came from like a dollar store for $4. And I'm gonna show you Well, it's nothing of a fancy deal, but I'm just going to show you the whole idea behind this of just making it with a little bit of a shield here. I just screwed it, you know, four places, and I'm going to put the cover on it here for you and show you that, yeah, you got to have a cover, right? So let's get to the cover part, and I'll show you how that all goes together. Well, let's just put the cover on it here, and it just kind of fits in here, and I got just enough room to stick my fingers back in there and snap it all on. And that's pretty much it right there. Well, what is the objective for this whole project? Well, in the previous video, I showed you the tools that I was going to use to dig a shallow well. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to set up a pumping system using a 12-volt pump. And I'm pretty sure I'm going to go with a SureFlow pump because I've had good success with them in the past. And I have to pump water roughly 200 feet from where my water source is going to be to where I'm going to want to use it. So this is all for the setup of this. And if you're taking a look at a system like this that I'm building, well, this is a really low-cost alternative. Like, this would never be acceptable to any building codes and that kind of stuff. This is way up in Northern Ontario. This is something that I do, right? I'm just showing you how I'm doing it and how I find it so easy to do myself. Now, for people who have never done anything like this, there's lots of great reading material out there. And what I did was I just went to my local store and I bought myself 27-foot extension cord, or 24-foot, I forget. And what was it now, 5 meters, something like that. And I find this is the best. Now, a 14-gauge cable is fine for what I need. And if I were to go to, say, your local hardware and just buy it by the foot, well, you'd pay a lot more, because I paid like 12, 13 bucks for 5 meters or 25 feet, whatever it is. But this is the setup here. And I'm going to be bolting this to my frame I'm going to make for the solar panel. So the solar panel, if you could just imagine, is going to be on a roughly a 45 degree angle. I'm going to have it mounted to a wooden structure. The battery is going to be built into the structure itself. This is going to have all self-contained. I have to be able to transport it, so it's got to fit in the back of my pickup truck. It's got to be able to fold down, and it's going to be an interesting build. I hope you watch for it in the future. And I'm just going to show the whole system all set up well when winter gets over, and I can actually mock it all up and show how it actually all works. I'd be very curious to see how good this low-cost charge controller is. Because you really need a charge controller. If you don't put a charge controller in, well, you're just going to boil your battery. That's all you're going to do, and wreck your battery. But there's people out there on the internet that are talking about taking a solar panel and running your load or your pump strictly off of the solar panel. And I didn't want to do that. I think I could if I went with a smaller pump. But I like to use this type of system because the battery will, of course, be depleted as you're using your pump, and the solar panel will keep your battery maintained and charged up over a longer period of time. Where if you just try and run it off your solar panel, well, what happens is a cloud comes over and your pump stops. The sun comes out, your pump starts. I don't like that kind of infrequency, especially when you want to pump some water. Now, I did show the system up at my camp I have before, and I'm using a submersible pump. I can pump 40 gallons in less than a minute, and I put it on a holding tank, and then I get my tractor and I haul it up the hill to where I want to use the water. The whole idea behind this is to no longer have to do that. I just want to go down there, flip the switch, pump all the water I want. So hopefully you can follow along in the series as I go, and if you stumble across this video, I'll put the links down below as I progress through, you know, through the videos. And hopefully this year you're going to see this system in operation. And like I said, this is how I'm doing it. Yeah, there's a lot of people that are going to be critical on exactly how I do it and the, you know, the different parts and the, well, you know, like a cheesy little box like this, right? I mean, nothing to this is the code, right? But this is something that I'm doing, and it's really an experiment because I have never tried to pump a couple of hundred feet, you know, but I'm pretty confident that I can do this with a pump that is valued at probably $150. I have one in the back of my shower room that I've been using now for well over 15 years, and it's never failed me. It's a SureFlow pump, and I'm gonna probably get another one of them. And I think this is possible, and it's so easy to do as far as, well, for me, I find it easy to do. And this is low cost, so I figure, now I've already had that solar panel that came off my cabin. I built a whole brand new solar panels. I got 400 watts there. I got a series on that. But this is going to be a low cost alternative where I figure I can do everything, pumping water, the whole bit, $250. That'll last me, well, a good 25 years, hopefully. So thanks for joining me here today, and hope you follow along with this project. If you haven't seen this channel before, you're welcome to subscribe and come back again, and let's have some more fun. Cheers.